All right, this is the second section of the American music lesson. We're going to go now to an art form that has become much beloved, much very popular in America, and this is musical theater. This is actually something, Broadway was originally something that grew out of the Harlem Renaissance and then also the vaudeville shows of the day. So we can thank the Harlem Renaissance, African American culture for musical theater, even though for a long time musical theater will be predominantly white, it doesn't matter. It's still influenced by that type of music. So where did it come from? There's a marriage of several things that create a modern American musical theater. The first is the what we call minstrel shows. These were the blackface shows of the 1800s. And then you also have people who wrote operettas. These were short little operas that came out of Europe, influenced by Europe, and they had more of a theatrical quality to them. And we have a duo here that's very popular. First guy is W.S. Gilbert, and the other one is Arthur Sullivan. You can see their dates. Gilbert and Sullivan. We kind of put them together now and just throw around Gilbert and Sullivan. They are kind of they wrote operettas, but really the first musicals. The most famous of those is probably The Pirates of Penzance, which you'll see occasionally performed. After them, the big duo of musical theater, this guy named Richard Rodgers and another guy named Oscar Hammerstein II. Rodgers and Hammerstein. This is a power duo for musical theater. Now, I know there's three guys here. The guy on the far left, that is Richard Rodgers. The guy on the far right is Oscar Hammerstein. And actually, just to show you how connected everyone was, the guy in the middle, that's Irving Berlin. So let's talk about some things that Rodgers and Hammerstein put together. I'm sure that you've heard of some of these musicals. First one, Oklahoma. And by the way, these are just the top five most popular. They wrote tons. So Oklahoma, Carousel, South Pacific, The King and I. I'm sure you've heard of The Sound of Music. If you haven't, here's a little clip of one of the most famous songs from The Sound of Music.
Let's start at the very beginning. A very good place to start. When you read, you begin with
A, B, C.
When you sing, you begin with Do, Re, Mi.
Do, Re, Mi.
Do, Re, Mi. The first three notes just happen to be Do, Re, Mi.
Do, Re, Mi.
Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Ti. Oh, let's see if I can make it easier. Do, a deer, a female deer. Re, a drop of golden sun. Mi, a name I call myself. Fa, a long, long way to run. So, a needle pulling thread. La, a note to follow so. Tea, a drink with jam and bread. That will bring us back to Do, oh.
Do!
A deer, a female deer.
Re!
A drop of golden sun.
Mi!
A name I call myself.
Fa!
A long, long way to run.
So,
a needle pulling thread.
La!
A note to follow so. Tea,
a drink with jam and bread.
That will bring us back to Do.
A deer, a female deer. Re, a drop of golden sun. Mi, a name I call myself. Fa, a long, long way to run.
So, a needle pulling thread.
La,
a note to follow so.
Ti,
a drink of
jam and bread.
Fa, sol, la, ti, do, so, do.
All right. No doubt you've heard that one before. Okay. So we have musical theater composers that are writing today. Just to show you that this is alive and well. The first one, a guy named Stephen Sondheim. You actually have seen a Sondheim musical so far. We'll go over that in a second. And then Andrew Lloyd Webber. He's a famous musical theater composer. Now, I will confess, we're talking about American music. Andrew Lloyd Webber is actually British. But this kind of still falls under the American music because musical theater really came from America. It's an American art form. Sondheim's, some of his most famous musicals, we've got Into the Woods, Gypsy, Sweeney Todd, The Demon Barber of Fleet Street. I showed that one in the second Viennese school lecture to show you what expressionism looked like. Andrew Lloyd Webber, Phantom of the Opera, Cats. I hear that movie just came out and it was just a total bomb, but famous musical. Jesus Christ Superstar. Here's a little clip from Phantom of the Opera. That may be Andrew Lloyd Webber's most famous musical. So anyway, none of the, what we talked about so far is really, with the exception of some Gershwin stuff, actually, we would consider classical or high art music. It's more of the popular music, but this is all very important because it helps to shape what this American sound is. This is a fairly new country, new culture, new society when you consider the world stage. You know, you take the German countries or Austria, or you take England or France, they've been around for a long time. America's not. So it's all very relevant. So let's talk about maybe the two most important musical figures of the 20th century in America. The first one is the composer Aaron Copland. And the second one is composer-conductor Leonard Bernstein. These guys, I think, are the giants of the 20th century in America. At least on the high art side. Aaron Copland, just to give you kind of an idea, he is the most influential American composer of the 20th century, if not ever. He may be the most influential ever. He started his career writing in avant-garde style. This is the real modernist European styles that we've been hearing. You know, kind of the Rite of Spring style or the expressionist or serialist style that we've talked about before. But he came, after he went and studied in Paris and came back to the United States and really worked on creating this American sound into his music. And he kind of specializes in these types of pieces. If you notice some of his most popular pieces, they have kind of an American-sounding titles. The Rodeo, we call it Rodeo in Texas, but he pronounced it Rodeo, so we call it Rodeo. Fanfare for the Common Man, El Salon Mexico, Billy the Kid, and Appalachian Spring. Here's a little clip from Rodeo. This is the hoedown from Rodeo. And by the way, take a look at who the conductor is. It's actually going to be Leonard Bernstein.
Thank you.
was a really famous beef commercial that came on TV years ago that would play that song, and then at the end it would say beef, it's what's for dinner, and then bum bum bum. So hopefully you can hear the American soundingness to it. It's kind of like cowboy classical music. And that's what Copland's music eventually kind of embraces and sounds like. Our fourth code word, by the way, is rodeo. Let's go to Leonard Bernstein. Bernstein, by the way, Copland and Bernstein were excellent friends throughout their lives. He's the first American conductor of the New York Philharmonic, and that's one of the great orchestras of not only this country, but of the world. They've always had European conductors, one of whom was Gustav Mahler. We studied Mahler as one of the post-Wagnerian romantics. But Leonard Bernstein was one of the conductors, first American. He became famous by doing these concerts. They were concerts for kids. People that were the age of my parents, so baby boomers, they would listen. It was one of the weekday mornings, and they turn on the TV, and there was the New York Philharmonic on TV with Leonard Bernstein talking to them and putting on concerts of great classical music for kids. They were wildly popular, wildly famous. He was also famous as a composer. He wrote many things. One of his most popular things that he wrote was actually a musical, and this is going to be West Side Story. West Side Story is a reenactment of the Shakespearean play Romeo and Juliet. And instead of two families, the Montagues and the Capulets, you have two gangs in New York. You have the, I believe it's the Sharks. Well, it's the Sharks and the Jets. I don't remember which name goes to who. One of them is a gang of white kids, and another one is a gang of Puerto Rican kids. And it deals with this racial tension in New York City in the 1940s and 50s. And you have Maria, who's this Puerto Rican girl who falls in love with Tony, this white guy. And it's really the Romeo and Juliet story. They want to run away together, even though it's this forbidden love. It turns out badly, just like Romeo and Juliet. And the moral of the story is, you know, let's get past this whole racial thing. This is ridiculous. The music in it is extremely complex, and I want to play one song from West Side Story for you. This is the mambo, and the mambo is it's for lack of a better way of describing it, it's a dance off between the two gangs at a high school dance. These are high school kids. They don't look like high school kids, but you just have to use your imagination. They're trying to get the principal's trying to get them to get along, but then they don't, and then there's this like dance off. So this is the mambo from West Side Story, and listen for that Afro-Cuban influence in the music.
Honey,
And then, of course, Tony and Maria see each other from across the dance floor. They fall madly in love and instantly love each other, just like real life. So anyway, this is what American music feels like, sounds like, in this early 1900s, from about 1900 to 1950. And this is what lays the ground for the postmodernist popular music that will come after it, which will include, you know, on the early part, Elvis and Chuck Berry, but the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, into the disco era. I mean, this all has to happen first in order for us to have the popular music that we now know as American popular music. So anyway, hope you enjoyed this. This is a really fun unit. I had to kind of fly by it, but if you have any questions, you need any help or anything, please let me know. You can email me. Email address is there. I'm on Zoom. I just log on every Tuesday and Thursday from 1 to 2. If you have any questions, feel free to just follow the link on Google Classroom. You can come on and ask me a question. It's just like coming by a classroom and asking a question that way. So anyway, you all have a good one. See you all soon.